It is one thing to know the stages of an industry life cycle, and another to understand them from a strategic point of view. Over the next few lessons, we'll dig deeper and learn more about each of the four stages. Here, our focus will be the introduction stage, the infancy of an industry. As we already know, it is characterized by low industry awareness among customers, technological uncertainty, high capital needs, and low levels of competition. There are two major ways to approach the introduction phase: participate in it from the beginning, or wait a while and enter later when customers know the products offered by the industry exist and there is a market for them. So, what should a firm do? Is it better to act as a pioneer, or is it preferable to be a late entrant? Well, there isn't a right or a wrong answer. Some managers see a lot of value in innovating. First, movers can assemble a team mainly driven by the desire to build a special product, one that has not been created yet. Naturally, these will be individuals not driven by monetary compensation. They are attracted by the idea. Frankly, this is the type of motivation you want on board initially. People inspired and willing to go the extra mile because they want to create something great. In addition, first movers gain a valuable advantage in terms of know-how. They are the first ones to get their hands dirty and can learn from their own experience. By the time competitors enter the market, first movers will have a well-trained team that understands the product and has a clear idea of how it can be improved. In some businesses, entrepreneurs are further incentivized by the opportunity to patent their innovations, which naturally gives first movers an advantage. The sooner they start working on a product, the likelier it is they can patent some of its features, which will make things very difficult for competitors. An example of a successful company that acted as a first mover in its market is Amazon. It was the first major online bookstore, a lead it never relinquished. Most colleges use Amazon's competition against Barnes & Noble as a case study example of first-class strategy applied in practice. Amazon grew its product offering, developed sophisticated algorithms to predict customer preferences, and developed highly specialized logistics skills, coupled with the ability to manage a huge inventory of goods. They simply knew what they were doing. However, the company acting as a first mover is not necessarily the one winning the race in the long run. Sometimes it's advantageous to be a late entrant. The introduction phase is almost always unprofitable. There are significant costs for product development and marketing. Research and development teams need financing. Marketing runs expensive informational campaigns. It is very difficult to break even. Technological uncertainties can be high, and there are no guarantees that a new technology that is much better wouldn't come up from somewhere. So, can we agree that participating in the introduction phase is very risky? Great. Some managers prefer to be more cautious. That's true mainly for larger companies that have an established core business and are unwilling to allocate resources and deal with new concepts. Instead, late entrants prefer to monitor industries in the introduction phase and act once customers are aware of the product and some are already purchasing it. Entering at a later stage allows them to exploit mistakes made by first movers and learn from them. Often, larger firms will acquire a fast-growing startup that has successfully gone through the introduction phase. That's another strategic option that could make sense and will combine some upsides for first movers and late entrants. Many companies have been really successful acting as late entrants. For example, the Ford Motor Company was the first to use an assembly line for its production of the mass-market automobile Model T, which was a huge success in 1921. The firm sold over 900,000 Model Ts in the first few years of operation and had a 60% market share. A few years later, in 1931, one of its main competitors, General Motors, came up with a differentiated product line and won 31% of the automobile market in the United States. First mover advantage didn't impede General Motors to take over the market and remain its leader until 2005. Okay, great. This does it for now. In our next lesson, we'll learn about some strategic subtleties in the growth phase. Thanks for watching.